XFM. Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM podcast.
Hey everyone, thank you very much for downloading the Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. We appreciate your dedication to the cause. Another good show today, though there was sort of moderate to mild hangovers all round because of the football kick game that happened last night. England taking on Italy, or as my girlfriend, who was trying to do impressions of lads to make me feel better for watching at home, called them the Baghettos. She go, "Oh, it's that Baghettos. We'll beat them, won't we?"
You just said dedication to the cause. I didn't know I was part of a cause. I just thought I had a sort of Sunday morning radio show.
Isn't that? It's a grassroots movement, mate.
Oh, right. Is it like Occupy?
Yes. Next week we'll be broadcasting from St Paul's Cathedral.
Oh, that's good. Interesting. You might be interested to know we donate our fees to UK Uncut.
It's broad use of the term "we." I make regular donations to women's charities.
Good. I love the fact he uses podcast as a platform for you to retain the moral high ground.
So this week we've got all our regular features, and also we've got a new way for you to get in touch with us. So this is especially relevant if you're a podcast downloader, because often you might hear stuff that you think, well, I've got a funny story attached to that. So we now have an email address, which is sunday@xfm.co.uk. So if you hear something in textual healing, or if you have an idea for a textual healing...
Yeah, particularly useful for that. I think we've already had a couple of emails, because we plugged it during the show, suggesting sacred cows. But with textual healing, if you don't feel that you can fit your problem into a sort of 140-character tweet, then do email us at sunday@xfm.co.uk.
Also, so for example, today we talk about, because it's Father's Day, we talk about dad stuff. So if you've got something you want to add to that debate, and we can read them out on the podcast intro next week.
Ex post facto.
Ex post facto. Don't worry if you're thinking we've gone mad. All will become clear over the next 45 to 55 minutes of the podcast.
Anyway, thank you for downloading it. Obviously, we're live every Sunday between 10 and 1. So, thank you very much. That's all from us. Goodbye.
Goodbye.
XFM, Ellis James and John Robbins podcast.
You're listening to XFM, coming to us, to you, live, should I say rather, live from Manaus in Brazil, where just 8 hours ago, England put up a spirited attack, but unfortunately lost out 2-1. To the Italians. Now we have 7 hours of live analysis, stats and interviews. With me in the studio is two-time Champions League winner, three-time Premier League winner, Mr. John Robbins. And to my left, the first Carmarthen-born player to score in the second round of the Johnson's Paint Trophy, Mr. Ellis James. Ellis, first reactions 8 hours on.
Johnson's Paint Trophy, that is, I mean, as references go, that's a 10 out of 10. It would have been better if you'd done LDV Van's Trophy, or even the
Simod... Well, that would have been 11 out of 10.
Yeah, the Simod Cup. the Zenith Data Systems Trophy from the late 80s. I mean, John, I feel proud of you like a father would.
Well, you have to bear in mind, I am a Bristol-born man. So the Johnson's Paint Trophy was the sort of jewel in the crown for Rovers.
Of course, of
and
course.
And years ago, a girl I was beginning to form a relationship with...
Court.
...was at the Johnson's Paint Trophy final watching Bristol Rovers. And I remember getting the live text updates so I could find out what time it would be possible for me to call her at the earliest possible time. It went to extra time and that annoyed me.
Oh, yeah. And how long did you go out with her for?
You know, so... Well, you're listening to XFM. I've got lots of great music and chat today. Have you had a fun morning, Ellis? We had to come in slightly early today, and producer Dave sent out an email last night, and I got up on time, as per, and I saw a tweet from Ellis at about 3 a.m. celebrating the fact that a Swansea player was in the Ivory Coast-Japan match.
Yeah, Wilfred Boney.
And I thought, odds on, Ellis doesn't get in the studio on time, beat me into the studio.
Yeah, because I'm a tough guy and I can cope with a couple of hours sleep. Yeah, I was up late watching Japan Ivory Coast. Unfortunately, producer Dave clearly had been up all night drinking because he was a little bit late and it spoiled my skit because I was going to walk in and pretend to be really drunk and pretend that he was going to have to sober me up before we went on air. And I staggered in thinking, this is going to be brilliant, and the studio was completely empty. I just felt like a complete idiot. But, yeah, but producer Dave, clearly he's been up all night.
Stella. I've not actually, no. It was a responsible night for me. I was in bed by 1:30.
Well, why were you in at 9:22, Dave, when you asked us to get in at 9:20 and I was here at 9:18 with a skit prepared?
Well, thank you for the skit. It was because I stopped off for a Burger King breakfast, actually.
Murderer. So, Ellis, you watched the game last night in a pub, a tavern.
Yes, I did, yeah.
With many of the great and good of the comedy world.
With XFM's very own Josh Widdicombe wearing a beautiful Euro shirt.
Like a long dress.
Yeah, he's wearing a little black dress.
I nearly went to that pub, but the problem was I sort of got my secured invite at about 9:00. And I had already watched the Uruguay-Costa Rica game in my flat. And I'd been out to Sainsbury's especially, because I didn't think any invites were coming in for Robbins. Because I can be, you know, I can be a bit of a...
Hard work.
Loose cannon. Rule breaker. So I'd been to Sainsbury's, had to go to 2 different Sainsbury's, actually, to get some stubbies. Because I'm not really a lager drinker, but I have a romantic attachment to their... cheap beer Des Moulins range, because we used to drink it when I lived in Bristol. So I was 4 Moulins in, and I was quite comfy, toilet access guaranteed, great view of the laptop. So my girlfriend...
You're painting a very depressing picture.
So I watched the game with my girlfriend, and she was aware that I was probably half my mind was in the pub with the lads.
Yeah.
So to make up for that, she dressed up as... all the lads in an attempt to make me feel like I was at the pub with my best mates. And I think what we can do, because I tweeted a picture of her, which Rob Delaney favourited.
That's amazing.
It's a big moment for me.
For people who might not know who Rob Delaney is, Rob Delaney is the sort of king of Twitter, isn't he?
Yeah.
In that he's got about 88 million followers, and he was made famous through Twitter. He was just a sort of fairly normal... I've gigged with Rob Delaney as well. He's a lovely bloke.
He is, and he favourited my tweet of a photo of my girlfriend making up for the fact we were solo in the flat. And maybe we can retweet that so you can get an insight into how I spent yesterday.
So is she dressed like all of the lads and all of your friends who were lads, or all generic lads?
Well, the attempt was both. What ended up was a bizarre mix of influences.
Yeah, I've seen it. She looks like someone who's on a documentary about Woodstock. It's the moustache I really like, because she's an attractive lady, but with a moustache. Yeah. A Frank Zappa-esque moustache.
And she sort of kept up the skit that she was a lad for slightly too long. It became slightly creepy.
I wonder if she was enjoying it.
I think so. She likes doing little skits. So
steal one of my pretending to be drunk in front of producer Dave skits, because, I mean, that would have been great.
So I went to give her a kiss on the cheek at about 30 minutes, and she went, "Oh, mate, what are you doing? How many of those have you had? You're mental, ain't ya? You need to get yourself a bird, mate." That was really funny. But then I said, "You do stop. This is creepy."
Yes.
And then she would counter it by sort of coming out of the lad character and going, "Oh, we can have cake and custard if we win."
Oh, that's fair enough. My girlfriend doesn't like it. I mean, she thinks that rugby and cricket are the same.
Right.
She doesn't like any sport, is the point I'm trying to make.
Yeah.
I convinced her that when we watched the Champions League final, that in the final it was Derby County playing England.
Wow.
Yeah. Derby County, her local side, and England are a country she's heard of. So, but she's trying her best.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's quite sweet, actually, some of the questions she asks.
Yeah, Sarah thought that... my anonymous girlfriend thought that Alan Shearer in the studio was Phil off EastEnders. And then she said, because the goalkeeper was wearing like a Dayglow kit, she said, well, he's easy to see. Why don't they all wear that? which is kind of fair enough in a mad way. And then she said, ooh, they're good with their legs, aren't they?
Yeah.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. XFM.
As it's Father's Day, I hate to break that news to you, but I think at least a third of XFM listeners, if you look at the demographics, are waking up hungover now and thinking, oh no, God. Is it as bad as missing Mother's Day?
No, because I think dads are the sort of people that would forget Mother's Day in general.
Yes, I agree. I mean, let's face it, I've forgotten them both in my time, but I did feel slightly guilty about forgetting Mother's Day, I think.
Also, walking in this morning, this early on a Sunday, the only shop that was open was Ladbrokes, which I found phenomenally depressing. Yeah. Like, Boots wasn't open. Post office not open.
So you can't buy a nail file, but you can put a bet on a horse.
And I would argue, if you're making a bet at 7:45 on a Sunday morning, you have a problem, and it's only open for those people.
Yeah. Or you're working nights?
Or collecting your winnings from the England game, if you bet on Italy.
Very early.
Yeah, so I think it's absolute hogwash. Okay.
But I think we should talk about Father's Day. So the coolest things your dad's done, the most embarrassing thing your dad's done. My dad was, he was one of those people who was more popular than I was when I was a kid. So people would knock on the door at my house and ask if my dad was coming out to play. Because he was a classic sort of slightly irresponsible father. He used to love embarrassing me. So I remember friends of mine were around and my mum was doing all the normal mum stuff. You know, she's bringing in sort of drinks and all that sort of stuff. Whereas my dad came in wearing his pants over his trousers.
Lovely
and
stuff.
Pretended he'd gone mad. And it was great. It was really good. They loved it. I was less enamoured. Oh, Dad, take your... And it forced me into saying, Dad, take your pants off, which sounds funny. I mean, he thought it out on almost as many levels as the Bible has been thought out.
Excuse me, Mr. James, can we listen to I Feel Fine? It's our favourite song. what we want to hear from you on 83936, the text and at XFM, is what's the coolest thing your dad's done and what's the most embarrassing thing your dad's done? I think it's quite nice to concentrate on the cool because obviously dads, everyone thinks they're sad and embarrassing, but has he ever absolutely nailed something? Has he ever really done well? Or done something where you've thought, oh, my dad's ace.
Yeah.
Sorry.
There'll be plenty of that. Do you know what my dad did once? I was pinching my sister in the back seat on holiday to I was just pinching her because I was cool.
In the back seat.
And we were driving through the Yorkshire Moors and he stopped and he got me out of the car and drove off, only for about 100 yards, just to frighten me. But it was really, really funny. That sounds worse. I mean, it's now...
leaving a kid on the moors.
Yeah, but like he drove for like 50 yards tops.
Right.
Just and then he stopped and then I had to get back in the car and apparently I was very quiet and I didn't pinch my sister again for about 5 years. But, you know, so that sounds terrible.
That's not cool.
It is cool.
Is it cool?
It taught me a valuable lesson.
I'll have to switch to mum's on this one for lack of source material. But my mum, I got an ice cream at a garden centre. Me and my sister got an ice cream from my mum. And I said, oh, it's not very big. And she took it out of my hand and threw it in the bin. Very valuable lesson.
I thought she was going to throw it against the wall. That would have been cooler.
Also, my stepdad, in the 70s, his son was having trouble with a bully at school. And my stepdad used to be in a Harley Davidson group. So the school bus arrived at school. He turns up on his Harley, like a big old proper loud Harley,
cool.
With his leathers and a massive bike chain round his sort of shoulder. And like my stepdad's a very gentle, sort of kind man, but thought, I'll put on a show. So he turns up on this bike, goes up onto the top of the bus, finds the bully and goes, you ever mess with my son again, I'll rip your head off.
Yes.
And just walks off the bus.
Yeah!
That is super cool.
The 70s was a different time. If you read Morrissey's autobiography, Morrissey was swimming when he was about 10 with his dad, and a boy pushed Morrissey into the shallow end. And Morrissey's dad got out the pool and chinned him. Just chinned this 12-year-old kid, which is one of... I mean, I love Morrissey's autobiography, but that page, I mean, that made me howl with laughter on the bus. But anyway, what we need from you is your cool stories of when your dad was cool, maybe the embarrassing stuff, but I like the cool dad stuff.
Yeah, cool dad stuff.
Cool dad. Everyone's got a cool dad to an extent.
XFM. Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM Podcast.
We are now heading towards the brink of our regular feature, Sacred Cow, where we nominate bands that we think are overrated, who don't deserve the acclaim, the coverage they get in the music press. And we want you to vote either for or against to decide whether the bands get put into our paddock of sacred cows or whether they're consigned to the abattoir, where they will join Messrs. Metallica, Floyd, Prince, U2, Bjork and Springsteen in a kind of bloodbath of
the overrated.
Of the overrated, with their pedestals being mashed up in a mincer and being given out as cat food.
What I like about you is whenever you talk about the abattoir, you end up going into this weird sort of abattoir fantasy. And I think you know too much about the workings of abattoirs.
Well, I, since becoming vegetarian, I have done a lot of research, Ellis, and I think you'll find, if you had the time to look into it, abattoirs are not quite the walk in the park you thought they were. They're actually, Ellis, pretty bad places, you know? So come
I know,
on.
I'm just as aware as anyone that an abattoir is, you know, it's not a pleasant working environment. But I'm just incapable of getting such radio music-based comedy out of it.
So it's my turn to nominate this week, listeners. Get ready to be offended, because this week I am nominating professional depressed Converse wearers, Nirvana.
Oh, dear.
And in classic producer's Dave style, he's picked an absolute belting riff to play.
John Robbins' instinctive air drumming has really kicked in. Dave Grohl would be very... I think you'd get offered a part in the Foo Fighters if you could see this.
No, he would say, you're just hitting the rims, you're not actually hitting the... Because I was friends with a drummer when I was about 14, and he was a big Nirvana fan, and whenever I mimed, he'd say, "That you're not doing it correctly."
Aren't boys great at that?
Yeah.
He should have been like, John, I love you. Best of luck in your sats. If that's how you want to air drum, go ahead. But because 14-year-old boys are like they are, they're like, oh, you're doing it wrong.
I'd go around his house and he'd say to his mum, oh, mum, John lent me £2 for lunch today. Can I borrow £2 to pay him back? And that was a lie. And he didn't give me the £2.
Ooh, well, I think we should talk about this later, because we need to talk about Nirvana. Now, like I would imagine, 99.99999.9%, that's not maths. Like I would say the vast majority of XFM listeners, I am a huge fan of Nirvana, and John, I can sense immediately how controversial this is going to be. They're one of the best bands ever. Kurt Cobain was brilliant. Nirvana rock. In Utero is amazing, Bleach is great, Nirvana Unplugged is brilliant, Nevermind is hit after hit after hit.
And all these things you just said, Kurt Cobain would have hated.
Yeah, he did.
The fact that you, a self-confessed mod, a man who wears Lacoste short-sleeved collared tops, who goes to the football games, he would have hated the fact that you like Nirvana. It's not for you, mate.
Oh, it's for sort of pathetic kids in the Midwest who get bullied.
Yes, exactly.
Very fair enough. They need bands.
So my problem with Nirvana is not they wrote great songs. Really good, really great riffs. My problems are threefold.
Right, okay. Hit me.
Firstly, they weren't the revolution that people think they are. They took that dynamic from bands such as Pixies and Sonic Youth, the quiet, loud vibe.
Okay.
And I think a lot of other bands who didn't make it super massive did that thing a lot better. That did grunge a lot better in the sort of late 80s, early 90s.
Oh, I don't know about that. There was like a lot of very dodgy grunge bands.
Mudhoney.
They were good.
The Butthole Surfers.
Yeah, they were good. Melvins.
Yeah, Sonic Youth themselves.
Yeah, although I saw Sonic Youth live in Bristol about 10 years ago, and there was a lot of distortion.
Yeah, but that's the vibe.
It was fine for 15 minutes, but I like oh, we shouldn't really talk about Sonic Youth, we should talk about Nirvana. But I think Nirvana were the best of those bands. And also, what was so brilliant about Nirvana was they have that sort of heavy, distorted rock, brilliant sort of riffs that were great, but also the melodies of ABBA, because he was a massive pop fan. Like, he loved Hey Jude, and he loved the Beatles, and he loved ABBA.
But everyone loves Hey Jude and the Beatles.
Yeah, but oh dear, sorry, I've just been sworn at.
Yeah, I knew that Ellis was bulking a very expletive-ridden, laden tweet.
That really took me by surprise, that.
Basically, to summarise the tweet, he says, come on, guys, you're talking nonsense. Nirvana weren't that great. 99.9% of listeners liking them, do go away.
Yeah, but uses the language of a Glaswegian docker in the 50s. Yeah. I mean, Alex Ferguson would have been surprised at that.
Also, I would say Bleach isn't that great. Come on.
It was
on.
Recorded for $606.
Well, maybe they should have spent a bit more.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. XFM. On XFM.
That was Dirty Harry by Gorillaz. Obviously, we'll be devastated to let that typo slip through the editing process, because that isn't how you spell gorillas. So we are XFM, we are Ellis James and John Robbins, and we are in the midst of our text conversation with you, the listeners, this morning. It's Father's Day, and we want to know, what's the coolest thing your dad's ever done, or stepdad's? So text us on 83936 and tweet at XFM with your stories of wonderful things where your dad has bucked the trend and done something, you know, that's really warmed your heart or made your day.
We've had a couple of absolute belters. This is my favourite so far. The first time I had a Glastonbury ticket in 2005, I found out that I had an A-level exam on the Friday morning. All my friends were going the day before and I was devastated. So my dad waited outside the exam with beers ready in the car, and as soon as I finished, he drove me at a possibly illegal speed from County Durham to Glastonbury, opening beers with his teeth so I could catch up with his friends, with my friends. That is just... I love that stuff.
Oh, that is just absolutely brilliant. What a great dad.
That is... Oh, fair play, Madeline. Malcolm, your dad, sounds like an absolute top bloke.
Big up to you, Malcolm. Though, just to be clear, it is illegal to have an open receptacle of alcohol in a vehicle. I'm not sure whether it's parked and the engine's off, it might be all right, but even then, you're going to get a talking to.
Can you be posthumously prosecuted?
We should change the names. Madeline, batten down the hatches. You don't want your dad to get arrested. Not, you said posthumously.
Yeah. I mean, okay. I mean, post the event.
Yeah, what's that in Latin?
Retrospectively.
Retrospectively is the right word, yeah. But there must be a Latin... What's the Latin phrase for post the event?
I don't know. Come on, producer Dave.
You've got to have a basic grasp of Latin to be a producer at XFM. that's a pretty great... Also, County Durham to Glasgow.
That's a big drive.
I was once, the first time and only time I went to Australia, we got a cab from a gig to the hotel, and the driver had an open litre bottle of Grolsch in the cup holder.
That is not cool.
It's very Australian.
Yeah. Did anyone call him on it?
The thing with cab drivers, they have a little bit of power. So it's like if they're going a route you don't agree with, yeah, and you kind of don't want to say, I think there's more traffic this way.
I can just imagine, you know, one of the parties saying, excuse me, I'm not sure it's really good to drink Grolsch and drive at the same time. And some Australian cab driver like, don't you poms tell me what to do. I'll drive and drink any way I like.
Yeah.
That's a
That's a great voice.
Oh, we've had a tweet. Sorry. I didn't mean to. I sort of shot you down there with my withering yeah. I should have joined in with the skit.
Yeah. That's all I want is for someone to join in with my skit.
If I can't drive my trailer with a can of Forex open, then what's the point of living?
What's the point in earning a ute?
Take it. If I can't drive a bottle of scotch on the way to see Jim Jefferies at play live, then what's the point of living? Take it.
So are you glad I joined in with the skit there?
Yeah, I think we were doing two different skits.
Just to confirm, before more music, our Latin literate listeners have absolutely nailed it here. Yes. Michael has tweeted in to say the Latin for post the event is ex post facto.
Thank you. That is now going to become an active part of my vocabulary.
Yeah. I'm not going to apologise at ex post facto. She ran too quickly across a zebra crossing, and I think at 4 years old she should have a basic awareness of the highway code.
So and if I'm going to drink Grolsch and drive a taxi at the same time, I'm going to be responsible for my own actions. You're listening to Ellis James and John Robbins here live on XFM.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. XFM. On XFM.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are in the midst of Sacred Cow.
XFM's Sacred Cow. Sacred Cow. Sacred
Cow. And this week, up for discussion, up for debate, are Nirvana. What a tune.
Yeah.
Well, absolute stone-cold belter. That said, I have nominated Nirvana today because, to summarise my reasons, the whole dynamic was stolen from other bands. Other bands did it better. And they are an artistic failure in that they shouldn't have got so big if they were actually that anti-corporation.
I'm going to hold my hands up and apologise to fans of Nirvana, because clearly I haven't done a good enough job of defending them, because some people texting in think that we're both nominating Nirvana. But I think Nirvana are great. I think they should go to the paddock. I think they're one of the most influential, brilliant bands of the last 30 years. And you can't be blamed for influencing bad groups if you're great yourself, because there are loads of dodgy punk bands, but that doesn't, you can't say that the Sex Pistols and the Clash aren't brilliant. Well, John can, because he doesn't like the Sex Pistols, but that's an argument we have off air.
So if you want to save them, if you like Nirvana, if you're a big super fan, you better get in quick, because it's approaching landslide territory.
And Lucy, I think you misunderstood. When I said I was too young for them, I was too young for them when they were releasing records. I then ex post facto got into Nirvana when I was a bit older, because I realised how great they were. But you know, when he died in 1994, I was listening to Michelle Gale's Sweetness. You know, my sweetness is my weakness. One of the first things I bought, absolutely brilliant. Hadaway, What Is Love?
When
KWS, Please Don't Go. I liked terrible pop music then.
When he died, all he knew was Queen, Man and Boy. And for me, at school, Nirvana represented the sort of layabouts, T-shirts over long-sleeved tops, that sort of smiley face, graffiti and the smoking of doobs, all of which I disagreed with fundamentally and still do. So for me, they were the kind of the Dossers band.
Yeah. The lads who aren't going to work hard and get into a very good university for school.
Queen were the band of people who got their homework in on time, did extracurricular work, joined clubs.
What clubs were you in? Chess club.
Chess. School magazine. Drama.
Were you?
Yes. Netball, but that was back in primary school. Me and my friend Robert were the only two boys in the netball team and the dance group.
Oh.
And on the school fete, we performed a quite taxing dance with scarves, because we both fancied girls in the drama class.
Because of...
dance class, sorry.
Because I went to a Welsh school, and obviously I had to take part in Eisteddfods, which are sort of traditional Welsh competitions that include sort of, you know, the reciting of poems and clog dancing. Some of my extracurricular groups were really, really dweeby.
Well, we've had some late support coming in from Emma, who says paddock all the way. An unnamed person says Nirvana, abattoir, pronto, pronto. So I'm assuming they're Italian.
Yeah.
But is it time, Dave, yes, producer Dave, to tot it up?
Yes, an interesting one this morning because there's a lot of passion both for and against, possibly the most passionate Sacred Cow we've had yet. People, very much on text, yelling at you two, both because they think it's ridiculous that they're even up for debate that they're going to go into the abattoir, but with about 75% of the texts and tweets... Nirvana are consigned to the abattoir.
Oh!
I am gutted. Somebody made a very good
That cow refuses to stay
Listen
down.
Listen to that.
Being shot in all of its seven stomachs.
Someone's making a very good point on the text that Nirvana...
It's absolute carnage out there.
The Nirvana are great, and clearly their fans are too apathetic to vote because they're just sat down smoking doobs and, you know, watching Sky News.
Well, guys, justice has been done. If you're going to smoke doobs on Father's Day, playing on your Xbox, thinking you're part of some kind of revolution, unlucky, because some of us are up early, getting our work done. Exciting news, folks. Because if you listen to the podcast or feel you sort of haven't been able to get out of bed in time to join the debate, we are now today launching a new email address. So what you can do, if you feel you want to comment on any of the features, you can email us on sunday@xfm.co.uk, and I guarantee all of your emails will be read personally by me. And then what can happen is we can talk about them on the podcast intro. We can also maybe talk about some of them next week if we get any absolute belters. And also, if you have any ideas for people you want to nominate for things like Sacred Cow, if you have a textual healing problem, that's the place to go. So do email us, sunday@xfm.co.uk.
Yeah.
Sorry, that was a rather sort of overly professional staged plug.
It was so professional it actually took me by surprise.
Yeah. So professional I sort of turned off.
SM, Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM podcast.
We've had a critique here from Lil Miss Chatterbooks with no O on Twitter. She said, I'm assuming you were attempting an Aussie accent. I'm an Aussie in the UK. Unless you sound like Home and Away's Alf, it's just not realistic. That's where you're bang wrong, Lil Ms Chatterbooks, because you've stumbled upon me and Ellis's talent goldmine, because we can do at least four different Australian accents between us.
Yes, I spent a lot of time in Australia, and I can do the more sort of middle-class Melbourne one. I like walking down Swanston Street and drinking a smoothie and maybe having a flat white.
And I can do, kind of, you know, the old guy is just sitting out on the main street watching the traffic go by. He's got a sign just to make sure, you know, his garden's watered with, you know, water butt water. He's not broken the water ban.
That's my grandfather you're talking about, so try not to be so dismissive. He's a really nice guy.
Oh, Ellis, you're so cute. Ellis, he's so dreamy. Ellis, I absolutely love Ellis.
My Australian accent that Little Miss Chatterbox thought sounded like I'm from Home and Away is based on a man who came up to me after a gig I did in Melbourne, and he genuinely went, I usually hate the guys at this show, and I expected to hate you, but I didn't. I thought you were okay. I thought you were all right. And I said, oh, thanks. And he slapped me on the back and went, yep, every year I hate the guy who does this, but you were fine.
That's a Brendan Burns accent, isn't it, for any comedy fans?
But this guy was way older than Brendan Burns. I mean, I think he sounded like he'd been drinking Cravel for the last 30 years. He'd come in from the country. He'd driven about 30 miles. Out of town to come into
to see something which he always hates.
That he always hates.
Baffling.
Yeah, that was the interesting.
So we've had a great text in about cool dad stuff. So do keep them coming on 83936 and at XFM. This is from Olivia in Sheffield. She says, My dad once booked tickets for me and him to see Saint Etienne in Sheffield just after they released Words and Music. As cool as that was, unfortunately, I had my first chemistry exam the morning after. I couldn't go. So, and this is where it gets good, he popped down to the local record store where they were doing a signing on the day of the gig, unknown to me, and got a poster signed for me with a good luck message for the exam from the band themselves.
Absolute quality.
Legendary dads. That's what we want to hear. Another tweet has come in. This is bizarre, but very nice phrase. 2 weeks before supporting Steve Marriott, my dad was kicked out of his own band for being a carpenter's apprentice. What does that even mean? Unless it means he was too religious.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. XFM. On XFM.
You're listening to XFM. You're listening to Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM. If you heard that sound, that was John Robbins preemptively tossing a coin.
I got so excited about the next feature.
And the reason he's excited is that it's, I think, both of our favourite features, Winner Plays On. Now, if you're new to the show, you'll need this explained to you. XFM, it's the big one. It's the FA Cup Finals, the Champions League, it's the World Cup, it's John Robbins taking on Ellis James on their chosen specialist subject. Five questions, and the winner gets to play their chosen track. So, John, you've won, is it 3 weeks on the trot now?
I have won, 3 weeks on the trot. Harry Potter won the Triple Crown last week against obscure four-piece band The Beatles, much to Ellis's chagrin, because he had really thought they were his bankable band, and showed to have a pretty basic knowledge of The Beatles.
Well, I actually think that you went too deep in an unfair way.
They're always hard if you don't know them. So this week, it's Ellis's topic is the 1988 Welsh Rugby Triple Crown winning team, everybody's favourite pub quiz round. And Ellis, what's your song if you win?
There She Goes by The Lars.
Cracking tune. And my track will be Comfortably Numb by Pink Floyd. So, let's flick a coin, get straight into it. Ellis, heads or tails?
Tails for wheels, please.
It's queens for queen.
Right, okay.
So I will go first, please.
All right, Robbins is going to go first. So five questions on his chosen topic, Harry Potter, which is a kid's book, but that's fine. Right, five questions. Question number one. What is the biblical quote on Harry's parents' grave?
Love is stronger than death.
No, the last enemy that should be destroyed is death. Why does Ron visit Madame Pomfrey in Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone?
Because he fell off a horse in a game of chess.
No, he was bitten by a dragon named Norbert. What does Pomona Sprout throw at the approaching Death Eaters from the walls of Hogwarts? I need all three for the point.
Oh, Christmas Day. A Bubo Tuba Pus. Is that correct?
No.
The tangly thing that fire doesn't like.
I don't know. I mean, I call this from Wikipedia because I will not...
Devil's Bane?
Mandrake's Snargleff pods and venomous tentaculars. What is Ron's pet rat called?
Oh, easy question.
They're all hard.
Okay, I need to close my eyes because I should know that. Oh, I do know that. Come on, give me 3 seconds.
I have to rush you, John.
Five, four...
I'm going to kill myself.
Okay. Who does Scabbers bite in defence of Ron on the Hogwarts Express?
Hermione.
No, Gregory Goyle.
Oh, Christ. Oh, no.
A whitewash. a whitewash. A historic whitewash for Robbins.
It's my first ever whitewash. Oh. It's our first ever whitewash, I think.
Wow.
Scabbers.
Scabbers the rat, mate. I mean, that's very disappointing. A whitewash for Robbins.
I think it's our first ever whitewash.
What it's going to do is going to affect our broadcasting now, because he won't be able to forgive himself. But that's fine. You need to pick yourself up, mate.
The only one that's annoying me is Scabbers.
Okay.
But
this is Michael Ballack, 2002 semi-final. He's been booked. He's not going to play in the final. What does he do? He scores the winner. So come on, mate. You've still got 45 minutes of radio to fill.
Right. Okay, five questions on the Welsh 1988 Triple Crown winning team, starting now. Who captained Wales in the 1988 campaign?
Bleddyn Bowen.
Correct.
Should we just stop?
No. Which unfortunately named Welsh player made his debut for Wales, coming on as a sub to play as a hooker?
Ian Watkins.
Yes, correct. By what score did Wales beat England at Twickenham?
11-3?
Correct. Could it be the first 5-0? With whom did Wales share the outright championship, as goal difference was not yet used to decide an overall tie?
France.
Correct. What was the name of the official video released to mark their victory?
Crowning Glory.
It was Return of the Dragon.
Oh, my dad's got it.
It's a hammering. Oh. At last. James, 4-0. Potter, absolutely trampled all over by 15 men, Welsh and proud.
Oh, and what a year it was, 1988. I mean, the questions you could have asked.
Well, I'm going to have to ask them next week, so don't tell me.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast.
Ellis, have we had any more texts and tweets in about dads?
Yeah, we've got a belter here. My dad, Joe, was a character to say the least, and he's done loads of mad things. Here's one. He always thought a particular pet shop was cruel, keeping birds in cages, and one night in the 1970s, he came out of the pub steaming and decided to put a brick through the pet shop window and set the birds free. He was arrested, and there was an article about it in our local paper. Embarrassing for us, but kids at school thought he was a hero. Joanne.
Now, I absolutely agree with him.
Freedom fighter.
About keeping birds in cages. I think it's perverse. And I love the fact he's just gone route one. You know, he's not written a letter to his MP. He's not joined PETA. He's just gone, I don't need to go on a march. I've got a brick. I've got an arm.
He's a vigilante.
Cracking. I wonder if any of the birds did get free.
My mum had a budgie when she was very little, and she got home from school once. And my grandmother looked very sad. My mum said, "What's wrong?" And she went, "I let the budgie out for it to get a bit of fresh air, but the door's open, and he's just flown away over Carmarthen."
Well, great. That's what budgies made for. It'd be like putting you in an anecdote-proof cage.
Oh, can you imagine? I'd be dead within hours. It's my lifeblood. It's me being in an anecdote-proof. Sort of force field. I mean, that would be kryptonite to me.
You wouldn't be able to connect with people from all walks of life, which I was thinking earlier, you do brilliantly.
Thank you.
You're very good at finding common ground with the working man, the businessman, the sports fan, the bookworm. Ellis has got a topic of mutual interest for all of them.
I'm like a tabloid sort of journalist. I know a tiny bit about everything.
Yeah. Whereas I know a great deal about Queen, which is sort of useless at social events. What did you think of the rumours Queen were going to split in 85? I don't really like Queen. Okay. Good. What are you doing?
See, it's all kicking off in Syria again.
Yeah, Queen never played there, so not really. You're not giving me much to work with here, mate, so I'm just going to pop off for a canapé. So, folks, keep your texts and tweets coming in. We'll read them out. We'll read them out if they're good and not full of swearing. Coming up, we have got music from the Arctic Munchie. Christmas Day. I just had a major lull there. Just an immediate 10-second lull in energy levels because I had a sip of Mountain Dew but didn't bring it up here, which has got a surprising amount of caffeine in it. The Arctic Monkeys. they're not a band named after smoking doobs in the Northern Pole. Arctic Munchies there. Sorry, sort of trying to cobble that together. So you are still listening to the first class radio of Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM.
XFM. Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM podcast.
Now it's time for our regular feature, Textual Healing.
Textual.
Textual. So it's that time of the show where a caller calls in with a problem that he or she may have, and John and I will offer our own unique form of advice, our own sideways look at problem solving. So we have a caller on line one with a problem for us to get stuck into. Are you there, caller?
I am. Hello, Ellis. Hello, hello, John.
Hello.
Hi.
Just quickly before we get going, do you want to stay anonymous or can we refer to you as by your name?
You can refer to me by my name if you want, yeah. Right.
What's your name, mate?
Shall I give you my name? It's Chris.
Oh, hello, Chris. Lovely to speak to you.
Hi. Nice to speak to you. Nice to speak to you.
So what's your concern? What's your problem, Chris?
Well, the problem is it's kind of bothered me all my life, really. It comes to a head sort of every 4 years, I suppose, during the World Cup. It's like the whole country goes a bit mad for it and pretends that England's going to win. I don't know if people really believe that England stand a chance of winning, but they say it. Anyway, and I don't know anything about football, and I feel a bit excluded, really, and kind of want to join in, and I just don't know where to start. It was like when I was 8 and there was a boy in class who had a Dungeons and Dragons game, and I just thought, I couldn't even work out how you started the game.
Yeah.
It's exactly the same thing. So I can't embark on it because I don't know what the first thing to do, to dress up as an orc or something. But yeah, that's what I was ringing in about.
Well, I had very similar problems at sort of school time. So I didn't know, I wasn't sort of really able to follow football that closely.
Right. And
so what I would do is sort of pick up words.
Yeah.
During games, so people would say things like, line it, square it, Robbins. Robbins, why are you always so rubbish at football? Why'd you kick it over there for? So I knew the words line it and square it.
Line it and square it. Yeah, and do you know what context you might use those in?
So I think line it.
It's unlikely I'll be playing with a group of lads, you know. And so it's very hard. I'm going to see it be in a situation where I feel I could just go square it.
So square it, I think, means when they want you to sort of play it across the pitch. And
okay.
Line it is where they want you to kick it down the line.
The good
okay.
news...
It's a bit like you've said something in Spanish and I've asked you to translate it and you've translated it into Dutch. but thanks.
The good news is you don't even need to go as specific as line it or square it.
Right.
I watch a lot of football and a lot of the stuff people shout is so generic you can shout it practically any time during the game. So I'm going to stand up now and I'm going to do a bit of a role play.
This is right. What
happens. Use it! Put
use
a
it.
Foot on it! Good
right.
knock!
Okay, so basically,
really
would you suggest if I like maybe... There's a family opposite me. I mean, I've noticed there are fewer flags and everything this year, but the family opposite me have flags hanging out of all the windows and everything. If I just sort of stood outside the house, I've got to trim the hedge at the front, actually, later on. If I was to stand outside, I bought some face paints and paint my face white with a red cross on it, and then just sort of hang around the street saying, use it. That might help. That might give the idea. Might give the impression that I'm slightly more involved than I am.
I think you need to be watching a game for the
oh,
sort of the
see,
phrase
it has to happen
away.
While you're watching. Oh, okay. I'll tell you what, because the man thing, I did actually go to the World Cup once.
Did you?
When I was in Spain in 1982, and I went with my dad, and I think it was a last ditch attempt of his, and we went along, and we went to 3 England games. I can't remember who they were. It might have been Uruguay, China and the moon. I don't know who it was. Anyway, we went along to these games. England, the moon was pretty good. And Dad was very excited. And I remember then feeling very conscious that I just didn't... Everyone around me made noise and, like, I don't know how to cheer, really, you see. I think that's the thing. So I kept looking at everyone, thinking, how do they do it? And they kind of make this kind of sort of animal bellowing roar. And my poor dad, I was sat there. I thought, well, it's 90 minutes I can't avoid. I'll read a book, and I took P.G. Woodhouse novels with me.
This is one of the best things I've ever heard.
Complete works of Jeeves, you know. So it wasn't completely wasted. I was very up to speed with what Jeeves and Bertie Wooster were up to.
But do you know what, Chris?
Yeah.
Two points to make. Firstly, the fact you were in Spain in 82... Was that where it was in 82?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
You have got a better World Cup pedigree than anyone I know who watches football.
Well, I know this is a ridiculous thing. I feel slightly like I have, but I feel also, say, imagining this afternoon, I've painted my face white, and then I've got the red cross on it, and I'm cutting the edge, and I'm going, use it, you narc. And then if anyone looks at me slightly doubtful, I did go to the World Cup in 1982, actually, true fact.
Or you can sort of
I'm not going to help things anymore, am I?
During a match, you can go... Oh, this reminds me of 1982.
Well, you've got to get robotic on the line. I don't know if that's me or you.
And also, another thing I'd say is I have a theory that 99% of football fans genuinely know nothing about the game because I don't think football is as tactical a game as punters and pundits make it out to be.
It's just people kicking around, isn't it?
It's not like rugby where there's sort of genuine sort of schematic stuff going on.
I actually watched the game last night with someone who is a sports writer for the Daily Telegraph. And it was fascinating watching a game with him because he would say stuff like, I just shout, use it, put a foot on it, etc. Whereas he shouts things like, this is very static from England.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Really?
So there you could maybe go advanced. Another thing I would say is I commend to you the Armando Iannucci sketch, which is about 10 years ago. It'll be on YouTube. And it's where he's playing a guy in a pub who doesn't know anything about football. And he's sort of trying to fit in by going, oh, that's sore. That's a sore challenge. Oh, there's so many foreign players in the game. And what he realises is, it's a brilliant sketch, he realises that all the guys in the pub are actually linked up with headphones to people outside in a van.
Who are telling them what to say.
Yes, exactly. And he goes out...
If only my life was as successful as an Armando Iannucci sketch, I'd be happy.
Well, go and check that out on YouTube.
I should have a look. Oh, that's marvellous advice. I shall do that. So you don't think I need to worry, hugely. I just need to sound more confident.
Yes, confident.
I have bought a barbecue because I do know, I'm conscious of the fact that when this happens, there's always a great British summer of sport, and you can only eat barbecued food. So the barbecue is fired up, and I have got 100 weight of sausages waiting to go on it because
well,
it
that,
is amazing.
That's a treat. Summer
sport. So that at least I've gone for that kind of thing as well, although I've let the side down by making a salad to go with it. I've done that. I just need to get the phrases right.
Well, we hope that that's given you some useful things to work on for the next match. Thanks so much for calling in, Chris. You've been absolutely brills.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you for all your help.
Ellis James and John Robbins podcast. XFM.
With their tribute to Ian Botham there, that was Walk by the Foo Fighters. You're listening to Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM. Now, earlier on in the show, we asked you to text in. What's that delayed laugh for?
Oh, I just love the fact that you see the word walk and you instinctively think of Ian Botham.
What, name another famous walker.
Well, I wouldn't think of famous walkers. I just think of the thing I do to get myself to the toilet and, you know...
Yeah, but I'm not going to say their tribute to ambulation.
famous walkers, Ranulph Fiennes?
No, climber, adventurer.
He's an adventurer, okay. Fiona Campbell, the lady who walked the world.
Don't know who that is.
God, come on, mate.
Oh, one of those people where it's on the BBC website and it's like, she got through 74 pairs of trainers, was mugged 8 times, hit by 2 trains. Why didn't you just fly?
It took her 10 years. What a waste of time. She started on the day after Live Aid, I think. I think she was on stage.
And finished on the start of Live 8.
Yeah. And there was a programme about her years ago. Janice Reporter was a valued friend. She's got the hips of an 80-year-old woman, even though she's in her 40s.
Oh, she's done great walk around the world. It's really great. She would have visited more places if she had flown.
Yeah, but think of the her carbon footprint if she'd flown to all those places.
Think of her actual footprint.
Yeah.
Anyway...
What I was trying to say was, earlier in the show, we were talking, because it's Father's Day, about cool things your dad has done, bucking the trend of the stereotype of dads being embarrassing. And we had loads of great texts and tweets. Keep them coming to 83936 or tweet at XFM. We've got an absolute stonker here from Evie. And she says, I'd just come out of my operation as I had scoliosis. And I was still delirious from the morphine. What's scoliosis?
It's a curvature of the spine.
Lovely stuff. Well, not lovely stuff. You have my commiserations, as I suffer from back pain, and it's a ruddy nightmare. I was insisting for... Yes, Ellis?
It's what Richard II had. You know when they dug him up from that car park in Leicester?
Yeah.
He had terrible scoliosis. Hence the hunchback, like as is mentioned in Shakespeare.
Lovely stuff. More facts coming up from Ellis James.
I know more about scoliosis than I thought.
Yeah. Anything else?
Just, it's bad.
Right. There we go. anyway, Evie had come out of the operation. She was delirious from morphine. I was insisting for my iPod, but it was back at home in another town. So my dad went 40 miles each way to get my iPod, and he came back with it and a punnet of grapes. That's from Evie in Bournemouth. Lovely stuff.
Oh, that is what dads are for.
Yeah, a lot of lift-based work.
Yeah, but dads love giving lifts.
Yeah, they do, don't they? They love talking about the routes they take as well.
Yes, that is a big thing.
A-road or motorway, I mean, it's always a toss-up at this time of day. Sometimes the A38 is the best way to go.
The problem with the sat-nav is it'll take you as the crow flies, and you just, you know, you can't program a sat-nav to have local knowledge.
And once I remember the sat-nav, it recommended I go via the M42, which would have added 40 miles onto the journey, but it only actually saved me a minute.
Because that's the thing with the sat nav, it doesn't have that image. I won't touch them. My daughter's got one. She wants one for her birthday, and I will use it with her just to show that, you know, I'm not a stick in the mud. But to be honest, there's nothing wrong with getting an AA route planner because the roads don't change. I mean, I bought my AA map in 2005, but at the end of the day, the M1 is still in the same place. It still takes you from north to south.
Dance.
XFM, Ellis James and John Robbins on XFM podcast.
Now, I've got two small incidents to report, Elle.
Right.
I live in southeast London, and I was approaching the train station near where I live, as I am wont to, using a modern futuristic electronic cigarette for purposes of stopping smoking, that I'm not condoning its use, that's my choice. And a man stopped me and said, "You smoking shisha?" I said, "No, it's an electronic cigarette." And he went, "Yeah, it's no good for you. You want to smoke weed?" Right, which has already put my hackles up because I'm against drug use. And I said, well, why would I want to do that? And I was worried it might get a bit aggressive. And He then started rapping at me, which I didn't know whether that was an act of aggression or whether it was a sort of a conciliatory move to sort of bond with me. I'm not a rapper, so how do you engage with
sort
that?
Of eight-mile rap battle.
Yeah, how would you have dealt with that?
Well, why have you called up your Wikipedia?
Don't say that on air. Just because we share the same screen.
Sorry, I thought you'd gone mad. I thought you'd forgotten your date of birth.
Oh, well, you've spoiled my next surprise.
Oh, right, okay.
First, tell me, how do you deal with a man rapping at you and encouraging drug use?
Head down, maybe tell him if he's got a problem to approach Citizens Advice. Although the queues are very long, in my experience.
And the Tories have made severe cuts to Citizens' Advice.
Right.
While they keep letting the bankers take home all their bonuses. And my second problem, Ellis, is that, as I predicted some weeks ago, my brand new Wikipedia page has been vandalised.
Oh, no.
Some chippy, cocky young tinker has suggested that... After growing up in Bristol and attending the Castle School in Thornbury, South Gloucestershire, my nicknames included Kessler's Yarn Bomb, Allied Turbine Bearings Limited, The Third Way, Mugabe Jazz Benefit.
That's Mugabe, mate.
Mugabe Jazz Benefit and Rickmansworth. Now, I don't know... Whoever's done that has got a unique comic brain.
Well, yeah. Oh, so they're not actual nicknames of yours?
No, not at all.
What, you mean you were never called Mugabe Jazz Benefit? Or
nor Allied Turbine Bearings Limited.
Oh, I find that very difficult to believe. Oh, so, okay.
Also, they've added that it says he is a vegetarian and mediocre car enthusiast.
Do you know what? I don't know who this person is, but I like their sense of humour.
Took me 8 years to get a Wikipedia page, and I'm worried it's going to be taken down because people think it is the place for tittle-tattle.
Kessler's Yarn Bomb.
I don't even know what that means.
Well, do you reckon that's a reference to the Danish boxer Mikkel Kessler?
It's so wacky, it could have been done by Noel Fielding. I mean, it's just so left field.
Well, I think Allied Turbine Bearings Limited. It's like your friend... Do you remember when your friend worked in... I can't remember his name, worked in that baguette shop and he was allowed to name the sandwiches?
Yeah, he called one of them Ham FM. And he called the tuna one Skullifant's Revenge. I've got a feeling, actually, that might be him. He's the sort of person that would suggest my nickname at school was The Third Way.
Ham FM is a very funny name for a sandwich. One of the funniest things I've ever heard that.
Am I allowed to tell listeners what my nickname was at school if it's slightly rude?
I don't know what it was. Can you write it down?
Yeah,
please,
I'm just writing
very
it
quickly.
Down. Oh,
this is
now.
Good radio, isn't it? John Robbins writing down his nickname at school to be passed by.
No.
Oh, can I have a look at it?
Yeah. Well, at school, my nickname rhymed with Robbins.
Oh, let's
dear. Just say that. And I never really had a nickname. Anyway, well, now I've got six I didn't want
well,
for
anyway,
the world to see.
You've, we're coming to the end of the show. You've been listening to Ellis James and Allied Turbine Bearings Limited on XFM.
And if you're listening to us now on the podcast and you want to add any of your tuppence worth about anything, then do email us at sunday@xfm.co.uk.
And also feel free to vandalise John's Wikipedia
no,
page.
No, because this will end up in it being taken down or locked, well, neither of which I want.
Yeah, but if I mean, yeah, because otherwise you won't be able to mention all of the awards you're yet to win.
Thanks.
If you like this podcast, why not check out some of the other great ones available to download at xfm.co.uk. XFM. The XFM Breakfast Show with John Holmes.
Let me give you an example of your news bulletin at 8 a.m.
The Queen, David Cameron, and the leaders of France, America, and Russia are all going to be in Normandy later, along with...
Nothing wrong with that, of
no.
course. However, at 10 o'clock, you do this.
I'm Matt Dyson with your headlines, and the Queen, David Cameron, and the leaders of France, America, and Russia are all in Normandy this morning, alongside...
It's fair to say you're more excited about it at 10, aren't you?
I realise that the news is actually more exciting than it is first thing in the morning. Music that rocks.